he just won from two initial positions. The season has to learn. And then the car has, after it has learned by itself, from any initial position, has to learn what it has to, of course, do the right thing. And in this case, it was even smaller. The size of the population was just three chromosomes, okay? And each chromosome, again, generated two classical chromosomes. This is the number of generations, and as I said, the population was there. And here are some other reinforcement learning models that are known in traditions. These are some old ones that was developed in the, also at Uki. And here, for you to have an idea of the average number of steps to reach the goal. So it has learned after, of course, some interaction, autonomously. It has learned and it goes faster than all the other models based on reinforcement learning. Okay? And one point that is important, that all models, of course, except the quantum, were trained with random initial positions, so many different positions. And the quantum inspired were initialized only in two positions, the worst and the best. And of course, after that, the testing, then it's any position. It's 1,000 initial positions completely random. Here's just to show that the velocity, the car position, I mean, in blue, it goes back and then goes up. Okay? And then there's a ton of them, I think it's a problem that everybody knows as well as very well-known benchmark. You have to control this pendulum by moving the car in order for the pendulum to be vertical. Okay, of course it has, forgot the word, even in Portuguese, a tolerance. It has a tolerance of, in terms of angle, but of course, if it goes above that tolerance, then the pendulum will fall. So it has to be in equilibrium. Okay? That is the idea. Again, there are many equations, they are not important, because it has to simulate the behavior of the pendulum in order to evaluate the system. So again, here are the four variables, the position, the speed, the pendulum inclination, and the angular speed, which is also important in this case. And the initial number of neurons were five, just five. Again, the evaluation functions was the number of steps, the system is capable of keeping the pendulum in equilibrium, okay? The number, the size of the quantum population, again, very small, just five. And again, for each quantum, two classical were observed. And the rest. And again, these are all known reinforcement learning methods. These are also, some of them are based on neural networks. And the quantum inspired provided, again, the lowest average number of evaluations. We began with five and then the process automatically changed, the topology reduced to four. This is just the behavior of the car speed and the angle of the pendulum reaching the stability. Okay? Any questions? Now we wanted to use the same idea to feed forward. So now it's a standard multi-layer perceptron, but again, I don't want to keep trying many different topologies by hand. So let's try to use this evolutionary process to find the best multi-layer perceptron topology first, of course, and the weights as well. So we're not going to use the gradient descent, no local minima, nothing like that. But now, since we don't want only to find the best weights, which of course we need the real representation, we are going also to use the binary because we want to define the best features, to find a feature selection using the evolutionary process, and also the number of neurons in the hidden layer. So the number of neurons in the hidden layer will be defined by the binary representation, and the feature selection is going also to be by a binary representation, but the weights will be via a real representation, okay? So that's why we call it BR in this case, it's not Brazil, it's binary and real. And the binary, as I said, is a feature selection, number of neurons. And in order to try a little bit further, it's not really important, but we try to select the best activation function for the hidden layer and for the output layer. And the real representation is going to be used only for the synapse, as in other cases. So now our chromosome, the white part is the binary part, where we are going to have alpha and beta, as we have seen before. So now alpha and beta has the same unit as I mentioned in the beginning. Alpha square is the probability of having a zero value for that quantum bit, and beta square is the probability of having a one value for that quantum bit. And the gray part are the real genes, where we're going to define the hidden layer weights and the output layer weights. In this case, only one hidden layer. Okay? And the binary part, we have the input variables. So let's say we have 30 input variables. So we're going to have binary representation. Those that will have one value will be used in the neural net. Those with zero value will not be selected for the neural net. The same thing for the hidden layer. Let's say we want to put maximum 50 neurons in the hidden layer. So we put 50 genes, but some will be zero and some will be one. The genes with one value will be used, and the ones with the zero will not be used. And these are also for binary for the activation function, as I mentioned. Zero was hyperbolic tangent, and one was a sigmoid. Yes. So we have a binary part and a real part. So here is the topology. We have K, which is the maximum number of inputs available in the data set. We don't know which are important, but we put all of them here. We have here NH, which is the maximum number of hidden neurons in our hidden layer. And then the output can be one. Here is just one possible configuration, but in this case we use for classification. So if you have four classes, we are going to have four neurons here. If you have 10 classes, 10 if you have one. And here is just the number of genes, again based on the number of inputs, the number of neurons here, and the number of classes. Okay? So the only thing that changed, instead of having the fully recurrent neural network here, now we have a multi-layer neural network that will be evolved using the same algorithms. The only difference is that it's not only the real configuration, the quantum evolutionary algorithm, but the binary and real configuration. Okay? So here we have this a similar algorithm. We only have to take care that we are now having two different parts of the chromosome. We have to deal them differently. Okay? So the initialization is very similar, create the quantum, the binary part the same way. Every alpha and beta will be initialized with 1 over square of 2 in order to have the probability equal probability for 0 and 1. And the real part is the pulse will be the whole size of the whole range of that specific value, in our case is the synaptic weights. We have to generate the classical individuals observing the same way we have done before, the binary and the classical. The two different things that we have to take care of is here. We have to recombine after we generate the quantum, we observe the quantum, we call it, by creating the classical population. We have to take care because the binary and the real genes are dependent. Remember that the classical, the binary part defines which neurons are active. So if one neuron is not active, all the weights of that inactive neuron cannot be evaluated and cannot be evolved in the real path. We have to take care of that. That's the only thing that we have to think about. But the rest is the same, okay?
Sorry.
And here is the updating as well. It's important. We have to update the binary part using that operator that moves the vector in the direction of 0 and 1. And the real part, that idea of shrinking or enhancing the width of the poles and shifting the poles in the direction of the best solution of the classical problem. Okay? In this case, we use benchmark from the UCI repository. I'm going to show some of the results, just to see if the results provided by the evolutionary process were competitive with other models. So in this case, we had all these nine benchmark classification problems with different number of samples. Some small, some higher, different number of variables as well. For some we have 52 inputs, and the system has to define from those 52 which features are most important. And some have binary and continuous variables as well. And here the number of classes. Most of them are binary classification problems, but some have two, in this case, have three classes. And because of to compare with all the other problems, we have done the threefold cross-validation with 70% for training and 30% for testing. So here is using those statistical tests. So in 8 cases, the quantum-inspired BR provided statistical better results. In 8 with equal average, and in 2 cases, it was worse. Okay. And we can see the average and the best. I'm not going to explain in details what is a spike neural networks, but just for you to have an idea how we can use the same quantum-inspired evolutionary models for a different kind of topology, okay? Which is a spike neural networks, which is also known as MoNs. Some people call it the third generation of neural networks. In this case, neurons send and receive information based on spikes because they say it's closer to how the neurons actually work on the brain. But it's very important that these spike neural networks solve problems that have spatial and or temporal properties. So the idea is when you have something that you have temporal or spatial or even both, okay, these neural networks used to sometimes give better results. So the idea is you receive some inputs here, any real number or binary number, it doesn't matter. But you have to transform in spikes, here are the spikes for the neural networks, and then you have the output. This is a simple topology. The input layer is called receptive field neurons. There are basic notions I'm going to show because they are useful to transform the real number into spikes. And the second layer is with RBF, the radio basis functions. And in this case, it's kind of an unsupervised learning, and at the output is a linear tensor. Okay? So here, just for you to understand how you transform a real number, can be the sound, or it can be some frequency, can be something, it doesn't matter. So in this case, it's a 0.3, it's a number from any of the available variables. But how do you transform in spikes? So these are the receptive fields. So depending on which Gaussian that fires first, so in this case, 0.3, the first one, because this is the delay, so zero delay, and then you increase the delay going down. So the first one to be fired is the third. So the third neuron will receive the first spike. Then the second is here. So it will be the second neuron. The third one will be here. So it's going to be the first one. So, okay, and so forth. So depending on which Gaussian fires in which order, is the order that you're going to provide the spots. So the spike and error network now can work because it receives spots, okay? So one of the parameters that it's necessary to define is the number of Gaussians. This is something that we don't know when we have to define, we have to try, so we want the evolutionary process to find this, okay? So the idea is to use this quantum binary real, again, because we are also going to do the feature selection. But in this case, it's to evolve a spike neural network, providing the feature selection and all the parameters of the spike neural network automatically. And as I said, this is a unsupervised learning, so it's for clustering. So usually you don't know the number of clusters that you have in your data set. And sometimes you have to try in some, like, Kakeian or something. And we here know the system will find the best number of clusters for you, also automatically. So here's the structure, we have the metric, we have the database, we're going to use the binary parts for the feature selection, some parameters that will also be provided to configure the spike neural network, and the fitness function is based on the silhouette, which is an unsupervised evaluation, it's a metric, okay? Here are some of the parameters. These are all parameters of the spike error network. One that I mentioned is the number of Gaussians. There are many others that relate to the neuron, how the neuron actually works, some parameters that's necessary to define. And all of them will be provided automatically by the quantum inspired neural network. So here is the binary part, and this is the real part. I'm going to show you three basic applications. One just for you to have an idea of comparing with other clustering algorithms. And then two real, let's say, problems, which is recognition of age and voice. This was a problem. A magical problem to evaluate voice of people, because we know the age of the person, but sometimes the voice is getting older and the person needs to get treatment. So it doesn't depend only on the age of the person. The person can be a professor, or can be a singer, and is using the voice wrongly and has to do some independent on the real age, the chronological age. Okay. So here are some data sets as well with the number of patterns, the number of features, and the number of clusters, and to see if the system was able to find this. And here are the comparison of a spike neural network, configured by hand, let's say, trying to find the best one. This is the same spike neural network, but evolved using a standard genetic algorithm. And here are the values of silhouette using the quantum spike. As you can see, most of the cases, the average is much higher than all the other cases. And here's the number of clusters found. So they are very similar in some cases, but this was done automatically, as I mentioned. The recognition of age. As I said, this is a method for characterizing the age of the voice, not the chronological age, because the chronological age we know. Okay. So this is a relevant problem to those people who use their voices professionally. In the early identification of the aging of the voice is really important for the person to, and the problem to be reversible. Because if you don't treat, maybe it will be irreversible. So this is very simple. You record the voice of the person. You have some pre-processing, you get some parameters, and then we use the system, the neural evolutionary process, to find automatically the clusters of the voices. Let's say the normal, let's say the young voice, the, let's say adult voice, and the elder voice. The data set was composed of male and female, but they were treated separately. And from people from 15 to 100 years old, there was a 100-year-old female, and actually the voice was very good, much better than younger, much younger people. And it found three groups automatically that we labeled, of course, afterwards, because clustering, you give the label after, okay? in young adult and elderly. And here is just the silhouette, but what is important is this. So in terms of age, we have the average age these are three speakers from the female data set that were incorrectly, let's say, classified. So this is a person that is considered adult, but because of the parameters, the system actually put in the elderly. So it was a person that was detected that the voice was getting older automatically. With another woman, 50, and another one, 40. And as you can see, the parameters are in the elderly range. So it was a person that needed women that needed treatment. And you see that 100-year-old was not good. The same thing was done with the men, okay? And two men in the age of 50, which shouldn't be older, the voice should be normal, were also considered elderly and needed treatment because the parameters were all in the elderly range, okay? And the third and last was something important for Brazil as well. I didn't know it, only after this project, that Brazil has some of the highest rate of lightning. And sometimes it's billions of lightnings every year. And of course in some regions, because we have huge transmission lines, the lightning can damage the transmission line, and of course it will be blackout if the lightning is disrupted. So we need to know if there is a group of lightning going in the direction of the transmission line in order to, in advance, change the flow of the electricity to a different line. So if that line is disrupted by lightning, it will not damage and it will not cause any blackout, okay? A lot of things to do, so this is a group of lightning, and this is the transmission line, just for you to understand. We also use this algorithm, the clustering, using the neural evolutionary of the spike neural network. The information about everything about the light and the location, polarity, the current, discharge type, everything. And we found some groups. This is actually an online because every time the groups change, so the algorithm has to be very fast. That's why we needed something that was the clustering, that the number of clusters can change from one time to another. And every time it has to, from one time to another, everything has to be evolved automatically and very fast. That's why we need the quantum inspired algorithm. So here are just final remarks for this first part. The quantum inspired is suitable for the neural evolution, as we mentioned. For different types of neural networks, different topology, as we have seen for recurrent neural networks, for fully, for feed-forward neural networks, for spike neural networks. We have done for ensemble as well, but I don't have time to show you. But it's really useful for supervisor, reinforcement learning approach, all of them. Able to select the input variables, topology, activation function, sign-up rates. And because it's a fast convergent, it's adequate for online. This is really important in many cases, okay? And it's also being used in other things. Okay, I'm going to try to show we have some time. Do you have any questions about this? Yes, please.
Why is it so fast compared to the...
Good question. Why so fast? This is really important for you to understand because it's the basic of the quantum inspired. The idea is fast because the number of chromosomes that we have is very small. You know why we can do it with a small, because what is the idea of an evolutionary algorithm, like a genetic algorithm? You want to map the whole search space. And you have a parallel search space. You have many individuals in different places. So you can see and you can explore the search space. So in this case, you have just three. But how these three are actually mapping the whole search space? Because each one represents not only one point, it represents, it can map, okay, with one chromosome, you can map many different solutions because it's a superposition of state. So that's why it's fast, because you need few chromosomes. Actually, it's similar to EDA. It's based on distribution, probability distribution algorithms. But the idea is the same. In this case, we have three, sometimes four. But with those three or four, you map the whole search space. And you need fewer generations as well. So that's why it's faster. I don't know if I understood.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other question? Well, I don't know. I'm going to try. I don't know if you know about fuzzy logic, because I know you have seen genetic algorithms and evolutionary algorithms and neural networks. I don't know if you have learned about fuzzy algorithms, but it's something also very important in many problems where you need to understand what is inside. Neural networks, it's very good. The performance is fantastic, but it doesn't explain anything. So why, for instance, you have a neural network that is pattern recognition and you recognize that, for instance, that client is not a good payer. So I'm not going to lend money to that person because he's not good. The pattern is not good. And then they said, no, your credit is denied. Why? I don't know. The neural network told me not to lend you money. So this is a silly example, but there are many, and many companies, they don't want something like a black box. And fuzzy logic, the main thing about fuzzy logic, although it's also a universal approximator as a neural network, although people say fuzzy, it is not this name, but it seems like something, I don't know, not mathematical. There is the whole theory behind it is also a universal approximator, like a neural network. But it's not a black box. Because inside you have fuzzy rules. You have if-then rules. And the fuzzy idea is because you can express as you think. You don't need to define things very sharp. For instance, if we say in Brazil, elderly is above 65. So yesterday you were 64, you were not elderly. Today you woke up old, which is absurd. You get older each day. You don't get older from the night to the other day. Okay? So you can't define some things very sharp. So nothing is really zero and one, true and false. Some things are actually limited. So that is what fuzzy logic. I want to actually I will finish with just introduction and maybe just for you to understand what is a fuzzy evolutionary model, okay? So this is basically what I want to present. So fuzzy inference systems, for those who haven't learned about it, I don't have the slides here. If you want, I can provide later more information. But the basic idea is that it's to put together these two important things, interpretability and accuracy. Of course, it doesn't matter. I want something interpretable, but if the accuracy is very low, I'm going to choose another model, of course, that provides me a better accuracy. So I want to have them together, okay? But usually it depends on the expert knowledge. I have to have someone that will provide the rules for me. I have to get an expert in, I don't know, in health insurance or in diagnostic of a certain equipment or a control. So sometimes it's difficult for us to provide these rules or even expensive to get this expert and provide us his knowledge. He's going to charge on it. So we want some model that from data will provide the fuzzy rules for us automatically. Again, we are going to use evolutionary algorithms to do that. Okay? So fuzzy evolutionary systems, the idea is to bring together Fuzzy Francisco.